So project risk management includes the process of conducting risk management planning, identification, analysis, response planning, and controlling risk on a project. The objective of project risk management are to increase the likelihood and impact of positive events and decrease the likelihood and impact of the negative events in a project. So the objective is to increase the likelihood and impact of the positive event and decrease the likelihood and impact of the negative event in the project. So here is the difference. Risk is an uncertain event or event that might happen in future. Issue is an event that has already occurred. Once risk is identified, its impact should be analyzed and the response plan should be prepared. Once the impact of issue is analyzed, the same should be resolved or escalated. There is no response plan to it. Again, just take a look of this response plan. We are not saying, we loosely use the term mitigate, but here we are not saying mitigate. We are saying response plan. Why we are saying response plan? We will see down the line why it is, because there is a reason for it. So as usual, plan risk management is the first step. So how to conduct a risk management activity for a project is what you define here. And if your organization already has a risk management process, your project should also follow the similar risk management process. So project management, unless it is specifically required to do something different. So project management plan, charter, stakeholder register, EEF and OPS are the inputs. Analytical techniques, expert judgment and meetings are the tools and techniques, and risk management plan is your output. So risk management plan may include methodology or the approach, tools, checklist, data source, classification model, roles and responsibilities, budgeting, frequency to review risks, risk categories, definition of risk probability and impact, revised stakeholder tolerances, reporting formats, tracking, risk breakdown structure as described below. Now all these are part of a risk management plan. So the first step that we do is we identify the risk. Okay, let's take an example. Okay, let's take an example. Let's do an exercise. Now you have heard about Jim Corbett National Park. Do you know what it is famous for? Yes, it is famous for tigers. Now there is a project where you are a project manager, where you have to take a team and you have to go to Jim Corbett National Park, and in the middle of the Jim Corbett National Park there is a small hill. You have to go on top of the hill and you have to plant your company's flag. So this is your project. Now can you tell me what are the different risks that is there for this project? Permission, improper road, navigation, weather condition, what else? sickness, season is basically about weather condition. What about food and water shortage? No. Safety measures is fine. No, another is going is a competition. So, I mean, let's not take that. Now, so what? Now let's do something. We have identified the risks. Okay. Now let us do something. Let us say what is the probability and impact of this. So let's say probability on a scale of 5. So tiger's probability is 5. What is the impact on the project? Impact, let's keep it at 5 itself. The reason, okay, wild animals, 5, impact, maybe 4, permission, probability is less. If you don't get permission, impact is high, but permission, probability of the permission is less. Improper road, probability is 4. Wild animals can be combined if you want, but here we are taking, because the reason is that maybe the probability is high, but it might not be as fatal as the tiger. Improper road impact is lesser because it may take more time, it may delay or something, but it is not as bad as tiger eating up everybody. Navigation probability is 4 or say 3. Impact is also 3. Weather condition, you can put a 3 and 3. Sickness probability is 3. Impact can be 2 because you can take medicine and things like that. Food and water shortage, probability is lesser. Impact also is lesser. Loss of communication probability is a bit higher, but impact can be less. Hill climbing, let's say probability is 3, impact is higher. Safety measures, probability is lesser, impact is lesser. So it does not need to have, I mean, for this example, it is not necessary to be accurate, but this is just an example. So now what we have done is, first of all, we identified the risk. Once we identified the risk, we did a qualitative risk analysis where we put some kind of a qualitative analysis and we have given a score for probability and impact. Now, once we have done that, we have created a risk score. Now, the point here is, based on this risk score, we need to take certain actions. Okay. Now, all risks you cannot take action. So, you as an organization will have some kind of a risk appetite and risk tolerance. Have you heard about these two terminologies, risk appetite and risk tolerance? Have you heard about risk appetite and risk tolerance? So what is risk appetite? Seth says tolerance is the limit within which the risk is acceptable. Okay. So what is risk appetite? How much risk you can absorb. Exactly. It's like your shares. Depending on your appetite, that is how much of, say there is a risk of losing. So how much of loss you can absorb. You can still run your project successfully without any effect. That is your risk appetite. So depending on your risk appetite and depending on your risk tolerance, which is that how much of risk you will accept and how much of risk you will try and do something about it, is your tolerance limit. Based on that, what you also do is you create some kind of a risk matrix. So let's say for example, here we can create a simple matrix. High, medium and low. So if you look at the figures here, we have, let's say, less than equal to 5 is your low. Greater than 5 and less than equal to 10 is medium and greater than 10 is your high. Note, there is a question from Gopi, that does it mean tolerance is measure for appetite? No. If I take the example of shares, say you invest 1 lakh rupees on shares. Now, your risk appetite means that if you have a loss of 30,000 rupees, it is okay with you, you can still survive. If there is more loss, you cannot survive. It will affect you. So you don't, you want to have a stop loss at 30%. That is your tolerance limit. That is, you can absorb 30% of loss as a worst case scenario. Whereas tolerance limit is that I will not do anything for any risk of 20% or more, 20% or less. Now depending on the appetite, you may decide on the tolerance, but it is that 30% need not necessarily be 30%. 30% is the maximum limit you can absorb, but your tolerance limit might be less. That's the difference. Now if you look at it, some organizations, depending on the risk tolerance and risk appetite, will decide that I will only take measures for the high risks. So what is the high risk? So what it means is that based on this, as per how you have defined it in your risk management plan, that what is it that you will take risk response, based on that you will actually define this matrix. These are all defined in your risk management plan, and accordingly you will decide which one to respond. Now we say that tigers and wild animals are the ones which we will respond. Now let's say these are the two issues, that two risks that we have seen. Now tell me what step you can take to avoid these, or what step will you take? In this example, what step will you take? You can get a guide. Okay, guide will not stop you from tigers. Guide will take care of your improper road navigation. Maybe you can say that you will take guns and ammunition. Excellent. Now let's take these two examples. Okay, guns, helicopter, fencing. Okay, now you are traveling, so fencing means you are saying that you have to go in a proper fenced car. Now suppose there is marshland, then you cannot go in car, you have to go on boat. So it does not take care of the problem 100%. So now let's take the example of guns and helicopter. Now gun will take care of wild animals. Okay, this is a response. Helicopter is another response. Gun will do one thing. Gun will allow you to drive away the tigers and wild animals. Whereas helicopter, you are actually not even going in that route, you are going from the top. So these are all risk responses. And there are different types of risk responses which we will see. This is perfectly fine, but what one more concept that comes up is helicopter. Now you can use helicopter, but once you decide on helicopter, there is another factor. Because of the helicopter, maybe weather condition will be a then serious issue. Because if the weather condition is bad, then helicopter cannot fly there. Or there is no place to land. So what happens is, because of your response, there can be some new risks which may come up. Okay, Syed says no need to land, just drop the people on the hill, don't pick them up. So you drop one person, he puts the flag, let the tiger eat after that, no issues. Only one resource will be. No, I understand, Syed, I was just joking. Yeah, so I mean, there are ways, but so this is what we are doing. Now let's come back to our PMBOK. So what is PMBOK saying? PMBOK says that risk management plan, cost management plan, schedule management plan, quality management plan, human resource management plan, scope baseline, activity cost estimate, activity duration estimate, stakeholder register, project document, EEF and OPA, all of these are input for risk. So every activity, every area of project management can have some risk. That's why all of them are inputs. And what is the tool and technique? You do documentation review, you do information gathering, you do checklist analysis, you do assumption analysis, you can use diagramming techniques, you can do SWOT analysis, and you have your expert judgment. And what you get is a risk register. So what we defined here at the beginning is your risk register. So we identified the risk. But risk register will contain more than just the name of the risk. Now what is the SWOT analysis? Strength, weakness, opportunity and threat. That is what analysis that we do for each of the risks that we identify. So what is the document review? Basically what you do is you look at the proposal or the statement of the work, you look at the RFP, you look at the project scope statement and project management plan, you look at the dependencies, constraints and assumptions, you look at the estimates, budgets and schedule, and from by analyzing all of these you identify the risks. So risk identification is an important activity. Checklist analysis. Risk checklists are developed based on past experience and historical information. Checklists are very useful and simple to use. However, no checklists cover all scenarios. Identifying risks that are not covered in checklist is important. Now, in our practical life, what we do is we have a checklist which some 100 years ago somebody must have, some poor project manager must have developed and created, which we are now copy pasting and continuing to create those checkboxes. I mean ticking those checkboxes and signing it off and keeping it as a document. So that is what we generally do, but actually you have to identify each of the project, looking at all of these documents, a proper checklist of all the risks. So brainstorming, Delphi, interview, root cause analysis, SWOT, these are all information gathering technique. That is, you are bringing the whole team together, doing these discussions to identify the risks. So it is the team members as well as the customer, your sponsor, all of them are, even in case you have a vendor, you will bring them together and discuss on the different risks that can be identified. One more point that needs to be understood always is risk assessment is not a one-time activity. Risk assessment is a continuous process. Generally what we do is we do risk assessment at different phases or stages of the project. So we'll do at the time of the business case, we'll do at the time of the charter, we'll do at the time of the requirements acceptance, we'll do at the time of design, we'll do at the time of development, we'll do at the time of testing, we'll do at the time of UAT, and finally at the time of closure. That is there any risk which is still pending. Cause and effect diagram, system workflow and influence diagram, which is also network diagram, is used to identify and the risks. Then what we do? We do a qualitative analysis. So what we did here, putting these values and creating this score, this is called qualitative analysis. So risk management plan, scope baseline, register, EEF and OP are the inputs. Risk probability and impact assessment, that is exactly what we have done. Probability and impact matrix, so this figure is a probability and impact matrix. Risk data quality assessment, risk categorization, this high, medium, low is your risk categorization. These are all your tools and techniques. Risk urgency assessment, that is when will this risk happen, and expert judgment are your tools and techniques, and project document update is your output. So you do a qualitative analysis. In most of our projects, qualitative risk analysis is good enough for the project. We do not need to do quantitative risk analysis. The next step is quantitative risk analysis. So if you look at it, what we did, we have found risk score by multiplying probability of the risk event into impact of the risk event. And what we create is, we also create a risk breakdown structure so that we are sure that we have taken each and every, considered each and every area from where risk can happen. So there can be technical, there can be external, there can be organization, there can be project management, there can be other steps also depending on your project. So if you create a risk breakdown structure, then you know it is, you have considered all the aspects, and for each of these aspects you identify if there is any risk. Like technical, external, organizational and project management should take care of mostly all of the risks in a IT project. So you can identify risk in each of these blue areas. That will give you the complete list of all the risk in the risk register during identification. Now here is an example of a condition project, conditions for impact. So what you do is, this kind of a definition is created in the project risk management plan, where you say that how you will say which one is low, which one is medium, which one is high. So project objective, very low, low, moderate, high, very high. Cost, insignificant cost is very low. Less than 10% cost increase is low. 10 to 20% cost increase is moderate. 20 to 40 is in high, and greater than 40% is very high. So you, like this, you define your criteria. This is just an example. So you can define your criteria depending on your project and how your customer is accepting it. So now we have to understand couple of points. One is PR risks and business risk. Now PR risk is only the negative outcome, the one that we know mostly. What is business risk? Business risk is both positive and negative risk. Now we wanted an example of a positive risk. Suppose while working, one of the developers creates a particular piece of code which now can be used by multiple programmers, and it will reduce the overall time of the project. Now that is a positive risk. And what you need to do, you will try and see if you can make it more generalized so that it is not only can be used in your project, but it can be used in other projects in the organization. So organization wide, they will be able to take advantage of it. So do you understand a positive risk? Another example is, you are working in a organization on a project, and because of your project, while working, you find that to make your project successful, there is need for another particular project to be conducted. So that is an additional project that you have to perform to make this project a success. So that is an opportunity that you get for a new project. That is also a positive risk. So project manager, team members, risk management team, customers, subject matter experts, end users and other project management experts, all of them comes into these meetings for identifying risks. So this is the kind of matrix that I was talking about. So you can create this probability impact matrix, and you can say what is high, what is medium, what is low. Then we come to the qualitative risk analysis. Remember, quantitative risk analysis. Remember, quantitative risk analysis cannot be done without doing qualitative risk analysis. So for quantitative risk analysis to be done, qualitative risk analysis has to be done. Now, quantitative risk analysis is actually using Monte Carlo simulation. So here what we do is, we use statistical methods and statistical tools, software, like there is a product which does Monte Carlo simulation, and we use that for identifying, for finding the probability impact of the risks. So these are used for things like this MARS. The vehicle that has gone to the Mars, and for all these rockets and rocket science and all these things. The reason is that there is a huge amount of factors which lead to different risks. So it is not possible to be done independently. So then what you do is, you use or you take the help of a simulation package and you use that. So the process of numerically analyzing the effect of identified risk on overall project objective is being done by quantitative analysis, and it is done using a tool called Monte Carlo simulation. So risk management, cost management, schedule management plan, risk register, EF and OPR inputs, data gathering and representation technique, quantitative risk analysis and modeling technique is a tool and technique and expert judgment. This quantitative risk analysis and modeling technique is done by using Monte Carlo simulation. So data gathering, one of the techniques is using a decision tree analysis. So you interview with stakeholders and subject matter experts. These interviews can focus on worst case, best case, and most likely scenarios. So you create a decision tree. Consider the implication of choosing one or the other path based on the alternatives. Each decision is evaluated for risk and impact. All positive and negative outcomes are evaluated. All individual EMVs are added for a decision or choice, and the option offering the highest EMV should be selected. We also do sensitivity analysis. It is also called what if analysis. Helps to determine which risks have more potential. Examines each uncertainty on its merit. All other uncertainty in the project are set to a baseline value. Individual uncertainty is examined to see how it affects the success. So what it means is that you identify different uncertainties, but you take one uncertainty at a time, assuming the other things are constant, and then you see what is the impact of that particular uncertainty. Expected monetary value analysis. So the EMV value of a project is or event is based on the probability and of outcome that are uncertain. Now this is one calculation which may come as an exam question. So one risk may cost the project an additional 20,000 if it occurs, but there is only a 20% probability of that happening. So your EMV is 20% of 20,000, which is 4,000. So EMV of opportunities is expressed as positive values. EMV of risks are negative risks are expressed as negative values. And decision trees are used for finding out EMV. Modeling and simulation, we have already talked about it. So simulations are used to identify the potential impact and uncertainty specified at project level. So simulations are typically performed using the Monte Carlo technique. Now Monte Carlo technique actually started off to find the probability of how many wins might happen in a casino. Now Monte Carlo is used in risk management also to do this kind of analysis. So it uses a large number of random probabilistic inputs. So look at this particular example of a decision tree. So what it says is that if you take option A, you have to spend 5,000 upfront. If you take that option A, there is 72% probability of impact and the impact is 55,000 if it happens. And there is 28% probability that there is going to be no impact. If you take option B, 25,000 is the upfront. There is 21% probability of 4,000 impact and there is another 79% of probability of no impact. Now how do you calculate what is the effect? So your minus 5,000 plus 72% of 55,000 plus 28% of 0, which is minus 44,600, is your net cost effect. If you take option B, even though you are spending 25,000, there is only 21% probability of 4,000 and there is 79% probability of 0, which means that you are going to your net impact is 25,840. Now if this is the scenario, in case of a negative risk, B is the better option. Even though you are spending upfront 25,000, your net effect is 25,840 as opposed to 44,600. Is this clear? Are we clear on this? This calculation. Same thing, now we are looking at it in terms of a positive scenario. In case of positive scenario, 72% of 55, this is minus, this is plus. So this is 34,600, whereas minus 25 plus this is minus 24,160. For in case of positive impact, A, the higher is the better. So A is the better option. In case of negative, lower was the better option. In case of positive, higher is the better option. Remember that. And also remember, in this case, this was minus 5,000, but this was plus 55. In the other case, this was also minus 55. Now, there are certain strategies for threat and certain strategies for opportunities as your risk response. When you are having a risk which is a negative risk, there are four things that you can do. You can avoid, you can transfer, you can mitigate, or you can accept. What does avoidance mean? Now in our example, what we have seen is we have talked about helicopter. That is basically a avoidance strategy. We are not taking that path itself. We are taking a completely different path and avoiding all these risks. That is your avoiding avoid response. What is transfer? Give me an example of a risk transfer. We all have transferred our risk in our life. Give me one example of that most common risk transfer that anybody has done, or rather everybody has done. Not bank. Yes, outsourcing is one example. Outsourcing is transferring your risk to your vendor. That's fine, but I'm looking for another answer. No. Shifting exam preparation to the last month before the exam? No, that's not. I'm looking at a different answer. Ashutosh was going in that direction but had not reached. I've given you a hint. No one? Insurance. Insurance is the most common transfer of risk. We all transfer the risk by taking insurance. The next is mitigate. Mitigate means you take certain action to reduce the impact or the probability of the project. So suppose there is a, so in our example, taking this gun or fencing are example of mitigation strategy. And finally, we have accept. Means there are certain risks which you cannot do anything about it. So you have to just accept it. If and when that risk happens, then you will see what action that you need to take on that issue. So that is your four strategy for negative risk. Similarly, there are certain strategy for positive risks. First is exploit. That is, you will try to see how you can get more advantage of it. Number two is share. Sometimes there is a potential for opportunity, but that opportunity you need to take help of somebody else. So there is a new project, but that new project you cannot take it on your own. You need a specialized area, so you go with some other vendor or competitor or even, and you jointly bid for that and you get the business. That is sharing of opportunities. Third, I gave an example that if there is a code which helps you reduce time of your project, you try and make it more generalized to use it in other projects also, that is enhancing. And here also, you cannot do anything about it, you can accept a new opportunity. That is also possible. So accept is something which is common to both types of risk responses. The others are different. Here it is avoid, transfer, mitigate. Here it is exploit, share and enhance. There is a question from Ashutosh, why is it mentioned as mitigate instead of planning risk response? Avoidance, transfer, mitigate, accept, exploit, share, enhance, accept, all these are risk responses. Mitigate means you are specifically taking certain action to reduce the impact or reduce the probability. So common guiding principles for risk response strategies for the opportunities are timely, effort should be appropriate to severity, one response can address multiple risks, more than one response can address same risk, by addressing the root cause more than one risk can be addressed, involve all relevant stakeholders when selecting strategy. So common response is acceptance. Passive acceptance requires no action, leaving the project team to deal with the impact of the threat and opportunities as they occur. The most common active acceptance strategy is to establish a contingency reserve, including amount of time, money or resource to handle known or even sometimes potential unknown threats or opportunities. Remember, we had talked about reserves and we had talked about contingency reserve and management reserve. Now contingency reserve is for known unknowns, that is only where we know that these kind of risks happens, that is known unknown, whereas management reserves are for the unknown unknowns. So we use these reserves to take care of the effect of the risk. There is a question to repeat the strategy for opportunity, the positive risks. So what we are saying is one strategy is to exploit. See, what is the idea of the opportunity? The idea of opportunity is to, like for negative, we are trying to reduce the impact and probability. For opportunity, we are trying to increase the impact or probability. So to do that, what we are trying to do? One, we need to try and exploit more the opportunity. So if we see that there is an opportunity to get a project for another 3 months, try and exploit and see if there can be more such opportunities, or this opportunity itself can be extended to, instead of 3 months, to 6 months or 1 year. That is exploitation, exploiting. Second is share. What I said is that sometimes there are opportunity, but that opportunity cannot be handled by your organization itself. So what you do is you share with some other party, a third party, and that third party even can be a competitor. So by that, what you are doing is you are gaining the advantage of getting that additional benefit, part of it to you, even though part of it you are sharing with the partner. Third is enhance. So what we said is that in the example, that if you have advantage where you see that you will be able to get a benefit of 10,000 rupees, try and see if you can enhance it to 100,000 rupees. So in that example, I said that we have a set of code which is written which reduces the programming time by half in your project. Try and see if you can generalize it to such an extent that it will also reduce the programming time in other projects that your organization is doing by using the same piece of code. So you are enhancing the opportunity. And finally is acceptance, where you cannot do anything, you quietly accept whatever opportunity that has come and you gain that much only. Clear? So avoid, transfer, mitigate, accept. These are the four things that we have seen. What we also need to understand, two more concepts, is secondary risk and residual risk. Now what is secondary risk? Risk that come from a response you have to another risk. Remember, we looked at the helicopter, and because of helicopter we have additional risk of the weather condition, because if the weather is not good you cannot take the helicopter up to the hill, or if there is no landing site then you cannot drop a person or land the helicopter to do the work. So these are called secondary risks. So once you do a risk analysis identification, if you don't, it is not over. So once you do a risk response, again you have to do another level of risk assessment at that point of time to find about secondary risks. And then there is something called residual risk. That is, after doing all, taking all the risk responses, still there will be some amount of risk which is lying. That will remain. Now, you should be bothered about the secondary risk, but not that extent as residual risk. Let the residual risk remain. Just identify and keep it. Once you do the next level of risk assessment again at the next phase, you will recheck the residual risk to see if the risk's priority and impact has increased. So let's take this example. Stormy weather and high winds could cause very slippery condition. So you put up a tent and wear a slip resistant footwear to keep you from losing your footing. What is this? Avoid, mitigate, transfer, accept. This is mitigate. You buy a large surge protector to make sure a lightning strike will not blow out all your equipment. No, this is also mitigate. Flooding could cause serious damage to your equipment, so you buy an insurance policy that covers the damage. This is transfer. Manufacturer issues a warning that the safety equipment you are using has a small but non-zero probability of failure under the conditions that you will be facing. You replace it with a more appropriate equipment. This is avoidance. You are not using that product itself. You are completely avoiding that and taking a different product. A mudslide would be very damaging to your project, but there is nothing you can do about it. Acceptance. Team member discovers that the location you planned on using is in a country that is considering regulations that could be expensive to comply with. You work with a surveying team to find a new location. No, this is not avoid. This is this is not transfer. This is avoid, because you are looking for a new location. You are not going to go into the same location. That's why you are avoiding the risk. Surrounding geographical feature could interfere with your communication equipment. So you bring a flare gun and rescue beacon in case it fails. Mitigate. So how do you control risk? You control risk by conducting risk assessment at regular intervals, by doing variance and trend analysis, and by doing reserve analysis to see how much of reserve is already eaten away by these risks and how much is pending, as opposed to how much of work has been done in the project. So more risk monitoring tools and techniques are risk audits, technical performance measurement, and status meetings. So you do risk audit to monitor and control, you do technical performance measurement on a regular basis, and you do status meetings. Now based on that, let us answer these questions. At every milestone, you do a new round of identify risk and make sure that the risk in your risk register still apply to the project. This is reassessment. You check to make sure that you have all of the features developed in your project that you had planned when you reach the feature complete milestone. When you find that you are missing one of the planned feature, you realize that a new risk has shown up. You missed one of the required feature in your functional specification. This is a technical performance measurement. You take a look at the number of defects you have found in your project per phase and find that it is higher in the project than it has been in most other projects that the company is doing. You dig a little deeper and find out some previously unplanned risks that have causing trouble on your project. No, this is trend analysis. You are looking at the trend. Your company sends a risk expert in to take a look at your risk response strategies. She finds that you are missing a few secondary risks that might be caused by the response you have planned. So you update your risk register to include the secondary risk. This is risk audit. You decide to implement a risk response that costs $4,000. You check to make sure that you have enough money to cover the rest of the risk that might happen from here on out in the project. This is reserve analysis. So plan risk response. Purpose of developing options and actions to enhance opportunities and to reduce threats. So risk management plan and risk register are your inputs. Strategies for negative risk or threats, strategies for positive risk or opportunities, contingent response strategies and expert judgment are your tools and techniques. Project management plan update and project document updates are your outputs. So we have already seen this, management reserve for unknown unknowns, contingency reserve for known unknowns. How do we control risk? By risk assessment, risk audit, variance and trend analysis, technical performance, reserve analysis, meetings. So work performance information, change request, project management plan update, document updates and OPA updates are your outputs for controlling risk. So that takes care of your risk management.